All right, so we're going to look at forming processes with sheet, tube, and wire. And we're also going to talk about shearing and punching, even though those are not technically really forming processes, but they're related. They usually happen very close together, sometimes in the same die set. So, shearing and punching, I guess you could say, are separating processes, but here we're going to lump them in with the sheet metal forming processes. All right, so in terms of sheet stock, this is what we'll be talking about: shearing, punching, blanking, fine blanking, simple shearing, slitting, and we'll look at a circle shear also. All right, so you are familiar with shearing, all right? So anytime that really you use just a regular pair of scissors, that is a shearing operation. We talked about shear stress earlier in the semester, and you did a lab where we had a piece of wood that had been placed in shear, and you saw where it had failed. And so really punching is also a shearing operation, but when we say shearing in terms of the metal working process, we're talking about something like this, where you go in, this is an example of a guillotine type shear, where the two blades cross each other and shear off a piece of sheet stock. So the cross section looks something like this. You have your piece of sheet steel or sheet metal in the machine. And it's going to rest basically here on the lower blade, and it's held in place with a blank holder. A lot of times this is a powered blank holder. Sometimes this is spring loaded as part of the whole upper blade system moves down and the blank holder lands first of all. But that's going to keep the sheet good and flat against this bottom blade down here. While I'm thinking about it, shears in general are fairly safe. I don't want to say that. They tend to seem really, really safe as far as the machine goes. But one of the easiest ways to hurt yourself pretty seriously with a power shear, these are hydraulic presses or mechanical presses sometimes, is to get your fingers underneath the work. And when you slide the work forward and you grab it and put your fingers underneath the work and slide it forward, when this blank holder comes down, that steel will, or the sheet metal, can just crush your fingers. So that's a real easy way to get hurt with a shear. Anyway, so the blank holder comes down and the upper blade comes straight down and will just basically slice through the work. The location of where the cut happens is generally determined by a back gauge. So sometimes front gauges are used, but generally you put the metal in until it bumps up to this back gauge. And these are, a lot of times digitally controlled, and you can move this back and forth to get the size sheet that you want. Now, when you look at the shear straight on, you'll see that the blades are in general angled like this. So this is the shear angle. And this is going to be different for different capacities of a shear. So if it has a very low shear rake angle, it's generally designed for thinner materials, and a more aggressive shear rake angle or shear angle for thicker materials. And this will also affect the amount of twist. When you try to cut a piece of metal off in a shear design for one size steel, it generally, or I keep saying steel, metal, it generally is not going to perform that well in a variety of other sizes. So you might have different shears for different thicknesses of metal. Now back to our cross section, you can see that there could be a number of actual angles on this shear blade geometry. In general, these up here on the upper blade are the ones that are not 90 degrees or not zero. All right, so a lot of times the lower blade has got a 0 degree lower rake angle, and this clearance angle can be 0 degrees. And generally, you see the clearance put on the moving side or the upper blade here. Now, something I don't want to minimize is this gap in here between the two shear blades. So that's something that's going to be critical when we look at shearing and also when we look at punching, to have this clearance in here. And generally, this is a percentage of the material thickness, all right? So more clearance for larger, thicker material. So what happens there is with this offset like that, that allows this crack to come through and kind of propagate a little bit more easily. It's not like you're transferring the load straight from this side or from this blade straight down into the other blade. that little bit of offset, that little bit of clearance, allows for this crack to form and propagate more neatly through the material. And this is kind of showing sort of typical edge characteristics. You'll see that there's going to be this little rollover edge. So what happens is the shear blades come down, they make contact, there's going to be a little bit of elastic deformation, and then the material will start to yield, and there will be some plastic deformation that happens. And then there will be a sort of burnished area through here where the shear happens nice and cleanly. And what's happening in the opposite side of this is the same thing in reverse. And what happens is this crack begins to form and propagate through, and then by the time this other piece gets pushed out of the way, it will roll over this little burr here at the end. So this is an actual look of a piece of sheet steel, and you can see pretty clearly, I think, those three zones there, or the four zones. There's this little rollover up here at the top, and then you see the nice burnished zone, and then that fracture breakout zone. And then you can kind of see, even though this is not the best view for it, you can see that burr on the back side, which is actually pretty small. This is a piece of 7-gauge, so about 3/16 of an inch across here. All right, and those are the three phases of shearing that we talked about: the elastic deformation, plastic deformation, and then that crack as it propagates through. All right, so punching is basically shear, but it's shearing around the periphery of a shape. All right, so this generally happens more or less simultaneously. You can have some dies that have some angles to them and things like that, but for the most part, usually just kind of simultaneous around the periphery of the part or of the shape that you want to punch out. So this is our iron worker downstairs just punching a piece of, I think, 16 gauge. Maybe that's probably something thinner than that, something I just had on hand. No, that's 16 gauge. All right. So that's a punching operation. If we were to zoom in, it's going to look an awful lot like the shearing operation. Okay, you're going to have this clearance between the punch and the die, and that same sort of characteristic on the punched edge. All right, it is essential that you're able to calculate the punching force required to punch out a shape, okay? In this case, we're dealing with a round shape, but it's not always so. So we're not going to talk about this in terms of circumference. We're going to talk about it in terms of its periphery or its perimeter. Now, you're given this formula that the punching force is equal to. That is the amount of force you would have to build up in this punch in pounds if you're using PSI for the ultimate tensile strength. So the force in pounds that is required to actually push through and punch this slug out of here is what you're calculating. All right, and you're given this equation, this 0.7 times T times L times the ultimate tensile strength of the material. Okay, what we want to do is make sure that you understand what's going on here. So this T times L, this T is in units of length, the L is times in units of length, okay? And when you multiply length by length, you get area, okay? You go from units of length, like inches, to units of area, like square inches, which aren't at all the same. Well, what happens is people look at this and they say, oh, I know how to calculate the area of a circle. It's pi times the radius squared. And yeah, that is the area of a circle, but that is not the area that you're looking for. The area that you're looking for here, the T times the L, that is the thickness of the material times the periphery, the distance around. So if we were dealing with a circle punch, that would be the circumference. Okay, so if we had a 1-inch diameter hole, then the circumference would be pi times the 1-inch would just be 3.14. Okay, so the distance around times the thickness is what we're looking for. We are not at all, in this case, interested in the area of this circle. We are interested in the area of the part that's being sheared off here. All right, so then there is this question of the ultimate tensile strength. Okay, now this is what you got to be careful of. Okay, well let me talk about the 0.7 first of all. So the 0.7 is to kind of is because the shear strength is not generally quite as high as the ultimate tensile strength. However, it says down here that some people use a full ultimate strength to build in a factor of safety. Now, that sounds backwards, right? It sounds like, well, if you're not sure what the ultimate tensile strength is, why would you use the complete ultimate tensile strength? And let me just back up and say that I'm going to kind of argue that I'd rather see a more conservative estimate, in which case I'd rather do away with this 0.7. Okay, I don't want to factor that in because I want to make a point of what would be a more conservative design decision in terms of designing tooling for this. Okay, so here is a place where a manufacturing engineer has to think kind of in the reverse way of a design engineer. So a design engineer, more conservative estimate is to say, oh, well, let's only use something like 60 or 80% of the ultimate tensile strength, or let's add a factor of safety. But, all right, let me unpack this a little bit. Let's just pretend that metal supermarkets are this is an actual authoritative source, okay? It's not. This is not where we're going to make our design decisions from the internet. But let's just pretend that it's right, okay? Let's just say that this is the actual range of ultimate tensile strengths for A36, okay? Which one of these is going to give us, should we as manufacturing engineers use as a number to design our punch around, all right? Would it be the 58,000 or the 79,800, okay? We want to use this because we want to make sure that if our material can range from this to that, then this is the worst case. The worst case is the stronger material in terms of designing this punch. We want a punch that's not designed for the weakest material. We want a punch that's designed for the strongest material. And that's why I'm going to make the case to just eliminate the 0.7. But if I give you a formula on the test and I say that this is the formula, then use that formula. Don't second guess the formula. I'll say, here it is, just use it. All right, so that's how you can mess this up, okay? Calculating the area is by an overwhelming margin. It is the way to mess this up. All right, remember, the area is where the shear is taking place, the area around the periphery. Now, in tool design, well, I shouldn't even mention it, but in tool design, you're going to have to see how much force builds up in this punch, in which case you'll need to know the cross-section of the punch itself. But that's a different problem. All right, so let's just take a look and at sort of a bird's eye view, see how well you're understanding this. Okay, we have two different punches. This one has a cross-sectional area of 0.14. This one has a cross-sectional area of 0.4. Which one is going to be more difficult to punch? Well, what you're saying, oh, you say this is totally irrelevant. Yeah, this does not have any relevance at all. It does from the actual side of the punch, but in terms of how much force it takes to punch these pieces out, it is the perimeter. It is the distance around these shapes that is going to make the difference, because we're going to multiply L, that is the distance around, times the material thickness. And this one has a larger perimeter, not by much, but by a little bit, has a larger perimeter than this hole. So it's going to take just a little bit more force to punch this rectangle out than it would to punch out this particular circle. All right, so moving right along, there is another process out there that's a way of punching that is a little bit more refined than just push in until the part breaks through a hole. And that's called fine blanking. And one of the key characteristics of fine blanking is this use of a counterforce, sort of this punch behind the punch to back up the pressure. And instead of having that rollover edge and that tear out, you get this nice burnished look all the way through, all the way around the periphery. Okay, so fine blanked punches or fine blanked parts can compete with machined parts in terms of sort of their precision. With fine blanking, you can also you don't even have to punch all the way through. You can take and sort of offset like this, so you can raise as if you're raising a boss on the surface. So you can actually halfway shear a part and leave it in place. So if none of that is making sense, be sure and watch these two videos here. All right, so the equipment used to do punching, so you can do punching inside of a die set, for instance, in a power press, like we've talked about. You can do punching like we saw in that iron worker video earlier, but a real common, I guess it's not quite as common as they once were, but it's still pretty common in industry, way of punching a variety of holes and shapes, and even doing a lot of different types of operations in terms of forming on sheet metal, is this thing called a turret punch press. So this is something to be familiar with. I put this little video on here, and it would be a good idea to check it out. But this is the turret. There's an upper turret and a lower turret that hold the punch and the die, and your punch tooling is going to ride inside of that turret. And what you do is put a piece of sheet steel in here, and there's some grippers that move the sheet X and Y and locate it underneath this turret, and the turret rotates into position and will then punch the sheet steel out, or the sheet metal, I keep saying that. There is a link to a GrabCAD page that shows this particular very nice turret punch press, and you can see here they've got the, whoops, come back. They've got the, you can see the little fingers are going to hold the sheet in place, and it's going to move the sheet in and out left and right. And there's your turret that has your punch tooling inside of there. But a pretty common piece of machinery. So a lot of this stuff gets done with lasers now, but you can do other things on a turret punch that you can't do on a laser. So you can do forming of things like louvers and bending and embossing and things like that. In fact, sometimes you see combination machines that have actual turret punch capability and laser cutting capability as well. And I put a video up there of this this guillotine shear that's cutting some about 1-inch thick steel. So that's kind of neat. If you've never seen these things before, then you'll want to watch those videos and kind of get the idea of what's going on there. It shows the back gauging system, stuff like that. All right, and then there are varieties of this. So you have like a right angle shear. So this is kind of the simplest case of a right angle shear. This is on our iron worker down in the in 122. You see it, you know, it shears that, and then you can bend this really nicely and then weld and make a nice corner that way. At the other end of the scale is a right angle shear that's designed to cut big blanks out of coil stock and sheet stock. So this is an example of that. You see, this has gone through probably a turret punch press already, or a laser, and how all of this this geometry punched out of it. And then the right angle shear just comes in and shears out the entire blank. So that's a pretty neat setup there. All right, another type of shearing is slitting. So slitting is done with rolls. What I will mention is that this is a pretty easy thing to get done. So when you buy coil stock, you don't have you have some choice over the actual metallurgy and over the thickness of the metal, but you have really good control over the width of that coil, because your coil is going to be cut off of a master coil to a coil that is whatever width that you would like. So when you order a coil of metal, unless you're buying millions of pounds a month or so, you don't have a lot of say over the chemistry and the thickness, but it's anybody can go out and buy a coil of a particular width, because that's going to be custom slit no matter what. And one more type of shear is a circle shear. So this is, again, uses rolls, but in this case you're rotating the part through the shear, and so a nice way to make round parts. All right, some other types. Now I guess we'll talk more about forming of sheet metal. These are some of the most common forming operations: deep drawing, embossing, hydroforming, spinning, and stretch forming. And they kind of get, they're not all as common. You know, stretch forming is not hugely popular, but it is in some industries, but not overall. But anyway, these are the ones we're going to talk about. So deep drawing is a process that uses generally a circular, but not necessarily circular, workpiece, and you draw it out. You push it, or it gets pushed through the die, and as it gets pushed through, it pulls the metal in. Okay, so that's why it's called drawing, because it's pulling the metal through this die. And what's really critical with this is the role that friction plays, and this blank holder. So what happens here is, a lot of times these are done on what's called a double action press, where the press has two different slides, one that actually drives the punch down, and another one that separately positions this blank holder down and puts pressure on the blank. Because if you don't have pressure on the blank, what will happen is, as you push this through, the top, this is just going to lift up and want to wrinkle like crazy. And so the die holder is there to prevent that wrinkling from happening. And you can have too much pressure where the material is not allowed to slide and it just shears off. Or you can have not enough pressure where it will, like I said, try to wrinkle. So it's called deep drawing when the ratio to of the actual diameter to the depth is pretty high, or I guess the height, the depth to the diameter is pretty high. So for deeper parts, it gets called deep drawing. All right, and here are the important factors. Lubrication. So lubrication is a big deal in this because you want to have a lot of pressure on the blank, and you want it to be able to slide to get a lot of control over the process. This drawing ratio, that is the ratio of the blank diameter to the finished part diameter. The larger the blank is compared to the part, the more troublesome it is. This blank holder pressure, like I said, in fact, there are generally whole specific types of machines that are designed with double action to provide you with control over the blank holder. Also, the clearance is a big deal. The radii are a big deal. The material properties are a big deal. All right, so lots of things can go wrong. It's really a difficult process to get right, and so there's just a lot that can go wrong. I'll just say you've even seen this tendency of parts, you know, to do this. So like an aluminum pan is kind of the classic, where the outside, this started with a longer length around the perimeter than it is now, and then when you shove that metal in there like that, it wants to wrinkle up. And so I'm sure that you've seen that on various parts. All right, here is that drawing ratio. All right, so there are two different diameters here, the diameter of the blank and the diameter of the punch. So you'd want to be able to calculate that. There's also this drawing force calculation, okay? And so I think you should probably be able to tease out what all of these things are. That P there, that's just pi. And then DP is that punch diameter. T is the material thickness. This is the ultimate tensile strength. And that's in PSI, not something like KSI. You'll want to make sure that you pay attention to those units. And then this is that same blank diameter and punch diameter. So not anything too difficult to calculate there, but they make good test questions. All right, sometimes when you're doing this drawing, you want to control the rate at which the metal moves into the die. So this, think especially for non-circular parts. Sometimes you want to sort of hold back parts of the metal and restrict them so that other parts will fill in a little bit better. And so these things called draw beads are integrated into a lot of drawing dies to pinch the material and prevent it from moving in a particular area so that you can have more material flow in one place rather than another. All right, and then ironing is a process that happens after the part has been drawn, and it's done to correct the wall thickness, okay? There's a real good video, you may have already seen it, about the design of the aluminum can. So, you know, some cans are made, they start as an impact extrusion rather than a drawing operation. But he does talk about things like ironing and, but, you know, that depends on the actual can that's being manufactured. But he does talk about the ironing process and this idea of drawing in multiple steps. So a lot of times you can't just do a deep drawing in one pass. You have to go through and do a sort of a pre-shaping until you can get the material worked into the shape that you want. And with some materials, you have to go in and anneal the material after each drawing step. So I think early on we saw that scuba tank manufacturing, where they would do a deep drawing and then they would anneal that part and then redraw it. All right, embossing is a way to raise a pattern onto a piece of sheet metal. Sometimes this is done with match dies or with a rubber die. Hydroforming is a pretty interesting process. I put some links out here to some images of some hydroforming or videos of hydroforming. So what hydroforming does is pressurize generally a tubular product with some kind of fluid, generally a liquid, and that liquid acts as a punch on the inside. It's a punch that conforms to the complete inside of the entire tubular product and sort of inflates that tube into the shape that is in the die. So a lot of tubular products that change their cross-section may start as a circle at one end and wind up being a square at the other, and a lot of times those are hydroformed parts. All right, spinning is a pretty interesting forming process, real common in certain industries like light reflectors, things like that, where you start with a disc of metal and you spin it, as the name would imply, and you use a wheel. In this case, this is a CNC spinning machine. Use a wheel to gradually shape that disc of metal around a mandrel. So that mandrel is the hard tooling on the inside here. All right, now let's talk about bending sheet metal. This is where you've wanted to be the whole time, I'm sure. All right, so bending sheet metal done inside of dies and die presses and die sets. Also done in press brakes, all right, and other specialized tooling. Different types of brakes, but a press brake is a really, really popular type. One of the most popular, common types of dies is a V-die. So there are two different ways you can do V-die bending. This is showing air bending. So air bending is really nice because, I don't know if you can see here or not, but when you bend a piece of sheet metal, you're doing this plastic deformation, but when you remove the pressure, the part will actually spring back. You'll have some elastic recovery. It will actually open up a little bit after the die opens up. All right, and with V-die bending, you're able to overbend slightly, and then the part will open up and spring back into the right angle. Another way to handle that is by using a coining die. So this is a bottom bending die, and so what happens with a bottom bending or coining die is the press comes down and it actually mashes, and the material flows in a separate direction along the length of the die, or the bend, and then when it recovers elastically, it doesn't actually unbend, it just reflows back in a little bit. All right, there are other arrangements of dies, like wipe bending, rotary bending, and these others. We'll see some of these. I would like for you to watch this this press brake video. This is pretty interesting. If you've never seen a full CNC press brake operate, it would be good to watch. All right, these are really common machines, and you need to watch this and understand what's going on. You can see you'll see the back gauge operate. Like I said, this is a full CNC. I don't know how many axes of control they have on this one, but it's a lot, and they have a really nice control system built into this that kind of shows you what the setup should be. They've got a really nice quick change tooling setup, and they have lights that show you where a particular tool needs to go. All in all, really a first-class setup. All right, so let me just make this point while we're talking about bending sheet metal. You will have used this little box and pan brake in Tech 1711 to make your coat rack project, and you're free to use it for senior projects. I recommend, first of all, that you design your stuff around 16-gauge. It's really easy to work with. It works with all our tooling. It's inexpensive, and it's strong enough for pretty much anything that you're going to make a senior project out of. But a sticking point has been this several times, in that somebody will design a part with a bend in it, or a couple of bends, and it turns out that the geometry does not actually work on this press, all right? It's this little box brake. And this happens in the real world, okay? You need to know that the die, that the tooling that you're using is compatible with the shape that you're trying to make. All right, so be able to verify that your series of bends can be bent on this, on the press. And I have this drawing. I can make this available to you if you're doing senior project. All right, in addition to being able to calculate the punching force and the stress that would build up in a punch, you also need to be able to calculate the bend allowance. All right, so taking a look at this bent shape, what we want to do is figure out how long this piece would need to be if we unbent it. In other words, what type of, what would be our blank dimensions? What would be our starting dimension? And where would we locate the bends? Where would they need to be? Well, You'll hear some people throw around rules of thumb like, well, you just subtract a material thickness or something like that. The better answer is to calculate the actual length, okay, based on what's called the neutral axis. So if we were trying to find our way to the actual way of calculating this, we might say, well, I bet maybe the distance around the outside of the part is the unbent dimension, or maybe the distance around the inside of the part is the length of the unbent dimension. And the answer is it falls in between those two. So it's not one or the other. It's actually a little closer to the inside, but where it is exactly is a matter of discussion. All right, so if we zoom in here and look at the actual bend, we realize that out here, this part is in a lot of compression, and out on the outside skin of the part, that's in a lot of tension. And in fact, sometimes that can cause trouble if you're bending with the grain, and you can get cracking and things out here, but I'm not going to talk about that. So this is in tension. In here, it is in compression. So that means that somewhere along here, there is a zone that is not in tension or in compression. And if it's not being pulled and it's not being pushed, then it never changes its length. And that is called the neutral axis. All right, and the location of where that neutral axis is can be calculated like this. So it is K, and in this case, we're going to use 0.4 times K. It is K times the thickness of the material, which is in this case 0.25. So K times the material thickness away from the inside of the bend. So away from the inside. Now in practice, this K value varies a little bit. As the material gets really thick compared to the bend radius, it goes toward 0.5. But as you start getting tighter and tighter bends for the thickness of material that you're using, it can go as low as 0.3. I've seen it as low as 0.33, I think. Maybe less than that. Now in general, it's not a good idea to go much, to have a bend radius that's less than the material thickness, but of course that's going to vary based on the actual alloy and temper of the material that you're trying to bend. All right, so what we do is we just take, and if we had our CAD system, all we'd have to do is offset the inside layer here, the inside perimeter, the inside path, by this amount. This is 0.4 from our K factor times the 0.25 equals 0.1. So we would just offset from the inside out 0.1 inches for this particular setup. And then to get the overall blank length, we could just say turn this into like a polyline, and we could list it and find out from our CAD system how long this line was. And that's how I do it. But anyway, there is a more analytical way to do it that we'll look at. All right, so to calculate the length of this line, first we'll need to know the length of the straight sections, okay? So the straight sections are going to look like this. We've got it 2 inches tall overall. So we start with it being 2 inches over. That's our finished dimension. And then we subtract from it this material thickness. So that's 1/4 inch there. And then we subtract from that the bend radius. So that's another 1/4 inch. All right, so the unbent part is 1.5 inches. Then what we need to do is to figure out the length of this arc. All right, so if we take this arc, which is the arc of the neutral axis as it goes through the bend, what we could do is just reason, and we could say, well, since this arc is 1/4 of a full circle, we could just take the circumference, which is pi times the diameter, which would be 2 times the radius, and just divide that by 4, because there are 4 of these. All right, so we just take the full circle, chop it up into 4 bits, and wind up with, we could use this little formula right here, pi times the radius divided by 2. And that would give us the arc length of this neutral axis around the bend. All right, so the overall blank would be this straight 1.5 inch unbent part plus one of these arc lengths, which would be 0.5498, plus the 2 inches in between. And of course, we found that the same way as we did these others, where we started with the 3 inches, we subtract a material thickness on this side, subtract a radius, bend radius here, and do it on both sides. So the 2 inches for the unbent section, and then another 0.5498 inches of length for the arc, and add to that this 1.5 inches of unbent length. That would give us an overall blank that was 6.0996 inches long. So that is the length of our unbent part. Now, there is a faster, more generally applicable formula for calculating these little arc lengths, and I'll show you that. That is this, okay? So this is how you can calculate the bend allowance for any angle, and just given the material thickness and the bend radius. So it's a lot less bookkeeping, and it works. It's a general purpose answer that works for any angle, not just 90 degrees. And I'll remind you that to calculate an arc length is actually really easy if you use radians, okay? Because the arc length is just the angle of the arc in radians times the radius. And that's actually what you see here. They take this angle in degrees, the bend angle theta in degrees, and what are they doing by multiplying by the pi over 180? They're converting that into radians. And then they're multiplying this times k times t plus r. That is the radius of the neutral axis. K times t is the offset, and then the original inside bend radius. That's what you saw here, all right? So this formula, one-stop shopping, it calculates the length of the arcs in the bends at the neutral axis. All right, then to locate the bends, what we need is, we'll have the distance from the edge of the part. We'll start with this inch and a half, that's the unbent part, and then we will add half of the bend allowance. Okay, no matter how we calculate it, we just get half of this arc length, add that to the length of the straight side. And that would give us this inch and a half plus half of the bend allowance, would be 0.2749, gives us the location of the first bend, 1.7749. And having a nice symmetrical part helps because then we know that the other bend on the other side would be that same distance. Now, I will say on some prints, you will actually see the start of the bend and end of the bend indicated. It's more common, at least in my experience, just to locate where the bend happens. I will say, if you have the chance, if you're ordering, if your supplier is going to be doing the bending, it is best to give your supplier, to give them a print of the finished part and let them do the calculation of the bend allowance. However, if you're the person that's having to do the bend allowance, you need to know how to calculate it. There's also a real nice PDF that somebody made available online for calculating the bend allowance. All right, there are other ways of doing bending besides a V-die, and so you should know what a rotary bender is. These are not uncommon. Also, wipe bending looks a lot like a shearing operation, except you have so much gap between the two blades, and they have a nice radius on them, that it just rolls the material over instead of shearing it. While we're talking about bending, if you ever get bar stock and you get it bent, sometimes there's two different ways you can bend it. You can do what's called bending it the easy way or bending it the hard way. And this is just a term you need to be familiar with. So bending the hard way is when you bend against the axis with the higher moment of inertia, the higher area moment of inertia. So this is a good example of bending the hard way versus bending the easy way. Completely different animal here. Wind up with a part like that. There, that's cool. All right, another way to do bending is with roll forming, all right? So roll forming is a series of rollers that shape the sheet metal incrementally. So this is how gutters get made. If you've ever seen like a gutter truck and they can pull a 30-foot gutter out of the back of a van that's only a few feet long, it's pretty neat. What they have in there is a roll forming machine that incrementally rolls the material into a profile. Now, this little video right here is test material, okay? So some of these videos are just kind of informative. This one is test material because it explains roll forming a whole lot better than I can with what I've got here, because they've got a roll forming machine. All right, so, and they do a good discussion of it, so make sure that you watch that. You'll see the elastic recovery happen as they do the die design. All right, another way of bending metals is to roll it into a round shape. One way of doing that is with this thing called a slip roll. All right, so you do this incrementally, roll it around, then you can make it tighter, and roll it again. All right, so while we're talking about rolling sheet steel or sheet metal into shapes, especially like roll forming, and we're going to look at bending pipe and tube, it's probably a good idea to point out that these are not the same animal. All right, so tube, first of all, doesn't have to be round. You can have square tube, different shapes of tube, rectangular tube, round tube, and then you can have this whole other thing that's called pipe. All right, so pipe, generally designed to carry some kind of a fluid. Tube can be used to carry a fluid, but it's also used structurally. Now, of course, you can also use pipe structurally as well, but they are two different products, and most importantly, they are dimensioned differently. So be sure that you're aware of that. If you get 1-inch tube, and then you go out and get a piece of 1-inch pipe, they are going to have very different dimensions. So we'll look at some ways of bending pipe and tube. Three-roll bending, kind of similar to a slip roll, but designed just strictly for bending tube and pipe shape. Oh, and while I'm at it, you know, the dies, since these ODs, the outside diameters, are going to be different, you'll have to have different dies for your bending machine, whether you're bending tube or pipe. This is a hydraulic ram or press bender, where you just kind of brute force push the pipe into the bender, which is actually kind of a form of compression bending. Here is a compression bender as well. So the main difference is, we'll see in just a minute, there's a big distinction between compression bending and draw bending. All right, so here you're pushing into the pipe to bend it. But one of the most popular ways of bending tubing, especially tubing in this case, for production purposes, and this is higher production type stuff, things for like automotive air conditioning conduit and fuel lines, things like that, is with a process called rotary draw bending. So make sure, if you've never seen rotary draw bending, make sure that you check out the video. Notice up here that the different radiuses, the bend radiuses, require different dies. Okay, so if you're going to design a tubular shape, just know that every time you put a different radius in there for that part to be bent, that's going to be a different die. And so much, much cheaper to design around a single bend radius than multiple bend radii. But again, this is draw bending because you're drawing the pipe out, stretching it around the die. And I'll just say sometimes there's actually a mandrel inside this pipe to keep the pipe from collapsing. So a lot of times there's a mandrel on a really long sort of stem that sticks out here and is holding the inside of this tube as it gets bent. All right, and then that same idea gets applied to wire bending. There's some pretty interesting videos out in the notes on wire bending and multi-slide machines. So there they're making some hose clamps. But just a series of some pretty interesting videos for you to watch out in the notes. All right, another wire process that we haven't talked about is to actually do drawing. And this can be done with wire or rod or tube as well. So this is going to reduce the diameter of these long round shapes by pulling them through a series of dies. All right, so in this particular video, this is the end. You have this really fine diameter wire, but if you skip along here, you'll see it goes through a series of these stations where it gets pulled. And notice that each time it gets reduced, it's going to go faster and faster because the volume of metal doesn't change. So we're going up towards the beginning, so these are going slower and slower, and the volume is not changed. And you can see this thing's wrapped around here a lot of times. That gives you a lot of friction to be able to pull through the die, and you're also able to kind of adjust and time one station to the next. All right, so that's the beginning wire, and it goes through several reductions through draw die. And you couldn't see it in the last one, but here they're doing some draw die, and you can see this stuffing box. You could see it. Maybe. Oh, here it comes. there. Before it goes into the die, there it's lubricated. All right, so that's the purpose of that stuffing box. It gets lubricated, then goes through the actual die itself there. Yeah, so if you ever wondered how they got flux into the core of such a tiny little wire, they actually put the flux into flux core in a larger diameter wire, and then they draw it down smaller and smaller. All right, so I think that's probably enough for an introduction to sheet metal forming and shearing operations.